স্যার স্যার স্যার
রেকর্ড
স্টার্ট
রেকর্ডিং
করুন।
আরম্ভ করব।
ইয়েস স্যার, স্টার্ট হয়ে গেল।
ওকে, গুড মর্নিং অল অফ ইউ। আওয়ার টপিক ফর টুডে ইজ সোসাইটি ইন সেন্ট্রাল সেন্ট্রাল ইসলামিক ওয়ার্ল্ড এন্ড দ্য সালতানেটস, এন্ড আওয়ার রিসোর্স পার্সন ইজ মিসেস তৃপ্তি দেও। উই ওয়েলকাম ইউ এগেন মিসেস তৃপ্তি দেও। And as I told you, Mrs. Deo is from JNU and now teaching in Delhi University as assistant professor. Let me speak something about the topic today. The religion known as Islam or Submission has been a much misunderstood religion by many people of the world. Although the Muslims are second in number, first is Christians, after September 11, this Islamophobia came and many saw Islam posing a danger to the world. But this is not so. If we look objectively, we will find in all the religions some bad elements. And we must know the tenets of Islam, what does it preach, and what Prophet Muhammad said about Islam in its pristine form. As you know, Prophet Muhammad from Saudi Arabia, born in 570 CE, after two or three decades of life, he began to ponder about the matter of society. And from 1605, he was going in the month of Ramadan to Mount Jabal Amur to think, to ponder. And in 610 CE, he got the revelation from Gabriel, messenger of Allah. And from that day onwards, Muhammad was known as Rasul Allah or messenger of God. And he preached the monotheistic religion as Islam. And 622, he went to Medina, and after his death in 632, Islam had become a well-established religion in Saudi Arabia. And after Prophet Muhammad, his successors were known as caliphs. And these caliphs, or as we call caliphs, they expanded the religion, starting in the west from Spain and North Africa to Middle East up to Iran. And under the rule of Caliphate, Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, and Ali Talib, Islam became a very entrenched religion. And when we talk of spread of Islam, there was not a single motive. Of course, religious fervor was there, or jihad was there, but much more than that, the zeal for territorial expansion and wealth also was there. After Prophet Muhammad died, his father-in-law, Abu Bakr, became the caliph. And Abu Bakr was opposed by a group of persons led by Prophet Muhammad's cousin and son-in-law, Ali. And the followers of Ali, they did not recognize Abu Bakr and regarded Ali, the fourth caliph, as the true imam. And they were known as Sihah Ali, Sihah means follower. And from that, the word Sihah has come. And there was schism in the Islamic world between Sunnis and Shias. Sunnis constituting about 85% of the people. And Abu Bakr followed the tradition or Sunnah of Muhammad. Sunnah means tradition. And from that, the word Sunni has come. So the schism in the Islamic world started from the reign of these caliphates. And after Ali became the caliph in 656 CE, the schism was very much oven, and after that gradually Islam expanded, and we'll be seeing in detail about various ramifications of Islam, the jurisprudence or fiqh, the shariat, by our resource person, this is Bhakti Deo. So I request now Mrs. Deo to give her lecture. Mrs. Deo, please start.
Yes, sir. Please continue. Start. Please start.
Should I start?
Yes, please start.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Mishra, for giving a little brief introduction to the entire unit that I will be taking up today. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for our online lecture today. A very interesting part of history today we'll be covering, and I'll spend about an hour lecturing on this topic of the Islamic, you know, the social formations and cultural patterns of medieval world, the societies in the central Islamic land. So whatever happened, whatever that I will be throwing light on will have direct influence not only in India but rest of the world. So a very, very interesting part of history that we will be taking up today. I have a couple of slides that I will be sharing with you, and through that slide I will share whatever I need to, you know, make you all understand on this particular topic. So I hope my slide is on the screen. Yes. Okay. So let's begin. The topic that we will be covering today is the social formation and the cultural patterns of medieval world, the societies in central Islamic land, and we welcome our BA Honours second semester students. Now, very clearly, it is the BHI 04 Block 4. So from the e-resource that you will be downloading from the website, this is what you need to you know, take reference of. And at the outset, I would like to just bring to all of your attention is that rather than looking at the political formation of the or the economic economic scenario of that period, although all of this is quite interlinked, we will be looking at what these societies were, the medieval societies were, the central Islamic land, especially the Arabia. So I'll also look at some of the maps to explain to you this part of the continent, and the medieval world we will be looking at, taking care of the social and the cultural patterns in this period. So the broad themes that I will take you through is first the tribal background, rise of Islam, and rise of sultanates. So we'll be looking at this for about half an hour. And the second topic that I will be taking up is the religious developments, and through that the religious developments related to the origins of Sharia. So very closely related to the study of Islam as a religion, the texts of the Islamic thought, we will be taking that up in the second point, the second theme, and I will be discussing this theme for about half an hour. So first let's look at the map of you know, this part of the world. So if you look at, if you can visualize the map of the world and see the Eastern Roman Empire, the Byzantine Empire. I'm sure since we're dealing with the second semester students, in your first semester, you must have studied this part of, you know, this part of the world, and I'm taking for granted that you would know a little bit about different regions around the world. Now, which is the Arabian Peninsula. I'll also show you through the other maps, but if you look at the right, the south, the right, if you look at the Ghaznic, Lakhmets, Hanifa, Giffar. So all of this, these regions are in the Arabian Peninsula that we will be looking at. Then is the Persian Empire, the Iranian Iran. Then if you look at towards the right is Sindh, Gujar, Vallabhi. Now this is towards the Indian subcontinent. on your right. The left part, which is we also called for India the West Asia, is this Arabian Peninsula, the Persian Empire, and further to the west is the Eastern Roman, the Byzantine Empire. So just keep these things. So whatever we will be discussing today is primarily not the Byzantine Empire or the Persian Empire. We will be looking at the region of the down south, if you look at the map, the Ghaznids, that Arabian Peninsula. So let me also show you this, the map of Arabia. So we have this Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Qatar, UAE, Oman, Yemen, then further on the north, Iraq, Kuwait. So all of these regions are a part of the Arabian Peninsula. And what we will really be focusing is on the Saudi Arabia. Okay, because the birth of Islam really happened in this region, the Mecca and Medina that we will eventually look at. Also keep in your mind the region of Egypt and Israel and Iran. I hope you can locate all of this on the map. Egypt on your left side, Israel on the top northeast, north,
hello,
and Iran.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes. I don't know. I think somebody is trying to ask a question here.
Yes, ma'am. You continue.
Hello, Nishant Sohuji.
Yes, Nishant. Yes. Takir sir, it's clear on.
Hello, Nishant.
What is it?
Yes.
Yes. Is somebody trying to ask
the
question?
No, actually he is Sakir sir. Sakir.
Yes, Dr. Sakir.
He is not audible. That's why.
No, so should I continue my presentation or do you want me to stop here?
No, ma'am. You continue, ma'am.
Okay, because there's a lot of noise coming from behind. So I was just wondering that are the participants muted for some time?
Yes.
So I'll continue with my presentation. Maybe if somebody has questions, they can take up in the end.
Yes.
Okay, Nishant, I'll continue. Okay.
Yes.
So, let me just go back to my current slide. Yes. So, this is the map that you must keep in your mind while I'm looking at. So, keep the Arabian Peninsula in your mind. And also, this map is about Arabia before Prophet Muhammad began with his propagation of the Islamic thought. Now, in this map, again, I'm bringing to you the Arabian Peninsula, the Arabian continent. Now, keep in your just pay attention to the Syrian desert, Syria. Syria, Damascus, towards, if you look at just below the Byzantine Empire, we have in the Arabian Peninsula, Syria. So keep that in your mind. Jerusalem, this is the region that you should keep in your mind. Mecca, Medina, around the eastern part of the western part of the Arabian Peninsula. Yes, so keep all of this in your mind. Also this Persian, the Sassanid Empire. So on the left is the Byzantine Empire and the right is the Persian Sassanid Empire. So this is also something that maybe you can just be mindful of, because I'll be touching upon these regions when I will take up more details on this particular topic. This is a map which focuses on Mecca Medina. So the birth of Islam really happened here. Okay, so I hope you can locate Mecca and Medina. Yes, so birth of Islam under Muhammad is this map around 622 to 632 CE, Mecca, Medina being the most important regions. Again, this is Mecca, Medina. I think in this map, you can also be mindful of the region of Jerusalem. We'll also be looking at that. Okay, so let's begin with our topic, the first topic, the tribal background, rise of Islam and rise of Sultanate. Now, there are about five themes within this particular topic that I will be taking up. The Arab world before the advent of the pre-Islamic period, before the advent of Islam, what was this Arab world? What were the people? How was the society and cultural settings in this region? The rise of Islam. We will also take up the rule of the first four caliphs. the Umayyad Caliphate and the Abbasid Caliphate. So this broadly will cover your first unit. Quickly going to what is this Arab world before the advent of Islam? Now, another point that I will also like to kind of make you aware before I begin my topic of the Arab world is just keep some of these terms which are not in the which are in Arabic, just know their meanings and keep going back to their meanings, because I'll be using them frequently. I will explain them in my lecture, but when you read and prepare your lecture, prepare for your topic, read from your e-resource. When you study about Islam and this particular period, you have to know a certain terms and words and their meaning. It will become easier for you to understand the context and the content. So the Arab world before the advent of Islam was, you know, according to the Quran, it is designated as a dark age. The period preceding advent of Muhammad was designated as a dark age. No central government to enforce law and order. The whole of Arabia, now when I say Arabia, please remember the Arabian Peninsula that one is talking about, especially the Arabian, the Saudi Arabian region. There were innumerable petty states, each clan forming separate and independent political unit. Each had a tribal chief. There was tribal prejudice. Bitter feuds continued for generations. So when you look at Arabia before Islam came, if Islam came around about 622, which is about early seventh, the second decade of the seventh century. Before that, Arabia was like this. There were small petty states. There were separate political entities. In fact, there was no monarchical or any kind of a political rule per se. There were tribal chiefs. And of course, when there were tribal chiefs and tribal clans, there were also continuous bitter feuds and conflicts between them, which were for generations. Now, the social condition was miserable. Actually, it was deplorable. It was steeped in immorality, human sacrifice, drunkenness. Literally, rum and wine shops were decorated, and they were the most happening places, if you can say, at this point of time in Arabia. Gambling was a favorite pastime. Adultery, adulterous relationship. Enemies were burnt alive, women and children massacred. So usury was in vogue. Usury is the idea of give and take, lending money. So basically, you know, the social condition didn't look very good at this point of time before the Islamic period. Because of the social conditions being so bad and deplorable, the worst affected were the women. They were regarded as chattels. That's the word that's used in your text. Chattels means that they were personal possessions. So they were personal property. They were treated as personal, one's personal property. So you can really imagine you know, what the plight of the women would be. They were embarrassed. People were embarrassed at the birth of the girl child, and they were buried alive. Slavery, obscenity, robbery, pillage, human blood was shed almost every day without any remorse. So that's the condition is designated as a dark age. And this was before Islam came in. Islam came around 622 CE. And before that, in Quran, the Arab world is depicted like this, literally. And sources have corroborated that, yes, Arab world's social condition was quite bad at this point of time. And I've already enlisted some of the points. Now let's quickly move to the rise of Islam. Now Islam, when the word Islam comes to your mind, it's a religion, clearly. And what else comes to your mind? Prophet Muhammad? What else comes to your mind? Quran, Sharia, Hadith? Yes. So these are words that are all interrelated, and we will be looking at them during the course of our lecture. So let's begin. Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam, established the Islamic State in the desert oasis of Medina. And it not only influenced the religion, but the cultural and political developments of that region also. So interestingly, the way Prophet Muhammad saw Islam and its spread was, it was just not a religious belief. It was also a political politically it was it also had political connotations. A lot of political developments were attached to this. So please remember this very, very important point. And remember where I had located Medina in, on the map of Arabian Peninsula. His first mission was to unify various sections of Arab society on the basis of a new principle of solidarity that he named as Islam. So Islam per se, he had the basis of Islam was to unify the sections of Arab society. And the basis was, it was on the principle of solidarity. Solidarity means that it on the principles of brotherhood, on the principles of community, that Islamic people practicing Islam would be a part of a big community, of a community. And they will be together, they will have solidarity as a community. So please remember that this is the prime principle that Prophet Muhammad had in his mind while he began propagating and talking about Islam. His clan, because he belonged to a tribal clan, and in Islam, the concept is tribal chieftaincy, tribal kinship. There is nothing called a monarchy or a monarch. That's not something that is acceptable, even thought of in Islam. So we will see that how, when you study Delhi Sultanate and Mughal period, gradually you will see that how monarchical rule was established. But at this point of time, around the 7th century, Islam really did not begin with the idea of any political leader per se. So his clan was once dominated by it, but gradually lost its position. As a young man, he interacted with many Jews and Christian monks when he traveled with the caravans. So that's the background that Prophet Muhammad is coming from. Around 610 CE, at the age of 40, he started having mystic experiences. Awareness, and what are these mystic experiences? He said that he had awareness of mighty and merciful God, whom man could only respond through worship and gratitude. So these are experiences, mystical, enlightening experiences that he's having at the age of 40 in about 610 CE. He's thinking that God is merciful. And God is the mightiest. And if you want to respond to the God, you have to respond to the God and seek his blessings through worship and gratitude. Gratitude is thanking God for everything. So man to surrender to God, who would judge him one day. So if a man wants to practice faith, who wants to come closer to God, he has to surrender to the God. Matlab, aap apne aap ko Bhagwan ke samne उनमें कंप्लीट विश्वास रखें, सरेंडर कर दें उनके समक्ष. एंड इट इज गॉड हु वुड जज हिम वन डे. कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ इंडिविजुअल रिस्पॉन्सिबल. सो व्हेन देयर इज अ रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन यू एंड गॉड पर से दैट इस्लाम इज टॉकिंग अबाउट, दैट इफ यू वांट टू बी क्लोज टू गॉड यू हैव अ डायरेक्ट रिलेशन विद हिम. सो दैट मीन्स दैट इट इज एन इंडिविजुअल रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी to get that, to come closer to the God. So this idea of individual responsibility was new. Islam is also a monotheistic religion. Monotheism, which means worship of Allah as worship of God of Abraham. So it is about worship of Allah. Allah is the God in Islam. And it also had influences of the Judean Christian influence. That's the reason it is said that worship of Allah is equivalent to worship of God of Abraham, which is the Judean Christian influence. Muhammad was the Rasul Allah, the messenger of God. So Prophet Muhammad himself did not treat himself as a God. The God was Allah. Prophet Muhammad was the messenger of the God. Because he experienced these mystical experiences, thoughts. So he treated himself as a messenger of God, a messenger whom the God wanted through him convey messages to people. right? So let's move forward to how Islam was propagated, how the followers of Prophet Muhammad gradually came up. So Khadija, who was Muhammad's wife, was was the first to accept his divine mission. Ali was, who was a cousin of Muhammad, were among the first to few to accept his divine mission. Now, what does Islam permit or does not permit? The Islam did not condemn commerce. So usury, for example, lending money, borrowing money is something that a number of religions do not permit. But Islam per se did not condemn commerce. It was, however, against unfair practices in commerce. So it also believed in equality of men and creator. Yes, but the real crisis that came, so Muhammad he belonged to a tribal clan who lost its who gradually lost its position. So the real crisis came when the tribal clan that Muhammad belonged to, when his clan chief Abu Talib died. This is my third point, if you see on the slide. Real crisis came to Muhammad when his clan chief Abu Talib died and he was succeeded by Abu Wahab. Now, this clan chief Abu Talib had still given a lot of protection to Muhammad and respected Muhammad and was in favor of Muhammad. But Abu Wahab withdrew his protection from Muhammad. So what would Muhammad do now? He started looking for a new home for himself. He began negotiations with various other tribes who came to Medina for Hajj, but he was not very successful. So Medina at this point of time, before Islam came in, was already a pilgrimage for Arabs, you know, for people across across the world. And whoever came to Medina, whichever tribes, you know, Muhammad tried to negotiate them, explain them his philosophy and his religion to gain more support, but he was not very successful. So what did Muhammad realize? He realized that if Islam had to survive, he needed political and economic power of a major tribe or an alliance of tribes. Okay, that is why the migration, which is referred to as Hijra, to the oasis of Yathrib, later renamed as Medina, is seen as a turning point in the history of Islam. So everything that Muhammad is doing is also seen as a watershed, as milestones in the development of Islam in Arabia and across the world. So his step to getting more support from other alliances, other tribes, and because of this, he migrated to this oasis of Yathrib, which is again in Medina, but later properly named as Medina, it was seen as a turning point in the history of Islam. Now, I'm moving to Mecca. Yeah, Meccans saw Muhammad as intolerable, as a political threat, as he claimed to derive his authority straight from God. So Mecca was something that Mecca was a place that was, and Meccan people in Mecca were not very happy with Muhammad, and he thought of Muhammad as a political threat. Now, at the outset only I had mentioned that we have to treat Islam as a political cultural change. Of course, it's a religion, but we have to see the political cultural context of Islam also, because you have to keep that in your mind. So Meccans saw Muhammad as intolerable, as a political threat, and more so because Muhammad said that I am having mystical experiences and I am the messenger of God. So the Meccan people thought of Muhammad as a threat. Muhammad started dialogues with delegation from Medina, and after prolonged talks, they agreed to give protection to Muhammad and his followers. So finally, after prolonged talks, Muhammad gained some alliances in Mecca and in Medina. And when he reached Medina, you know, that is symbolized as that is symbolized when he reached Medina on the 4th September 1622 CE. Now, this is an important point. It is symbolized by the decision to begin the Islamic calendar. So a lot of you must be must have heard about the Hijri calendar, the Islamic calendar that is still followed. Now that begins from 622 CE, and this is because this particular date is symbolized when Muhammad reached Medina, and that milestone development was commemorated as the beginning of the Hijri era, the Hijri calendar. There were also constant intergroup warfare and killing. This was always there at that point of time in Arabia. Historians and scholars studying this period have stated that they are very fortunate to get the copy of the Constitution of Medina. Now this is a particular document that has been passed and preserved for historical times, in the sense it is a document of that contemporary period. And this charter regulated relationships in the new political entity in Medina. Now this particular text, Constitution of Medina, is like a charter, it's a draft, which talks about relationship that the religious relationship that people of Medina and Prophet Muhammad had. So this charter regulated relationships in the new political entity in Medina. It explicitly stated that they are a single community, and the word community or ummah comes from here. Yes, comprising two major groups, the Muslim emigrants, who are called the Muhajirun, and the host in Medina, who are the Ansar. Now, Jews were also protected in their religion. Muhammad was the undisputed leader of the Muhajirun, and with the other, it was the more of a moral relationship, moral authority. He was accepted as an arbitrator, Hakam, however, had no power to enforce his judgment. So this we get information from the Constitution of Medina. Now, this is a very important document for historians, because we get a lot of information about how Muhammad and his relationship with people in Medina, his followers and other people who are not following have. So we can clearly see that he was treated as an undisputable leader. But whatever he's saying, Muhammad is saying, to enforce that particular judgment, he doesn't have power. So he still has a long way to establish his power. And how is he doing that? Now, if you look at the third point in my slide, Muhammad proved to be a successful military leader too. And please go to your e-resource for the military annexations and expansion that Muhammad is doing. And that proves him as a successful military leader too. And this boosts his authority. It confirms to the truth of his mission. And therefore, more Arabs began to convert. So we can clearly see that Muhammad realizes that for propagation of his religion, it is not only political, but even militarily, and military connotations are also involved in that. After repeated defeat of Meccans, so let me take you back to the Meccans, who are anyway anti Muhammad's mission. Repeatedly Meccans were defeated, and you can see and read from your sources, you know, from your e-resource, that why are Meccans constantly at loggerheads with Prophet Muhammad. After repeated defeats, Meccans realized that they would have to reach a compromise with the Muslims. Now here the word Muslims is used for people practicing and following Muhammad. All right, people following Muhammad, people practicing Islam, that is a religion that Muhammad is talking about, those are called Muslims. So primarily people in Medina practicing Islam are Muslims. Okay, so they Meccans realize that they will have to reach a compromise with these Muslims. Muhammad made a gesture to Meccans by trying to go to Kaaba to perform Hajj. Finally, a truce negotiation was received successfully. Meccans surrendered without a fight in 630 CE. Now, please familiarize yourself with the word Kaaba. Kaaba is the central building in Mecca, which is generally hailed as a pilgrimage, important pilgrimage monument. And you must be knowing the word meaning of the word Hajj. Now, Meccans had to finally surrender without a fight in about 1630 CE. Now, many pre-Islamic rituals were incorporated in the new religion. People were accepted in the Ummah. Ummah is the community, the Muslim community. He realized that the ground realities often superseded his religious mission. So Muhammad was, he was very, very intelligent in understanding that his was not only a religious mission. Ground reality was that if his religious mission had to be, had to expand, had to be followed by other people, it involved many political, economic, cultural, and military moorings also. It had these connotations also. It was just not a religious mission or a religion that he would think that would can easily be propagated. And whatever rituals and traditions of the pre-Islamic period were there in Arabia, they were also incorporated in Islam. It wasn't that everything was negated in whatever religion was practiced in pre-Islamic period was negated. So even Muhammad was careful in incorporating what in Islam, the pre-Islamic traditions. So after the conquest of Mecca, he was an undisputed leader. Now, Medina, of course, was his was already his base, and Mecca also surrendered. And now he was an undisputed leader of Mecca and Medina. He possessed the supreme authority in Ummah. So Ummah is the community. My second point already states what is this Ummah, which has two major groups of Muhajirun and the Ansar. It is difficult to distinguish his political and religious role. So again and again, I'm coming back to this point that his is just not about a religious leader. He had to prove himself to be a political leader, a military leader. Yes, so it was just not about political or religious roles. In fact, all of this were pretty combined with each other. People, Christians and Jews and those who did not accept Islam were known as Zimmis. Another word that you must keep in your mind, Zimmis, who were the protected ones. So Ummah of Medina was a heterogeneous group. Now Ummah was just not of people who were his followers. It was a heterogeneous group. Again, go back to the e-resource, understanding more about this Ummah. It was united by religion and not blood ties, and acted as a large tribe with Muhammad as their chief. So if you look at the tribal relations are largely on blood relations, or you know, extended blood relations. But the large tribe that Ummah is talking about is tied and united by religion and not by blood. And who is heading this Ummah? It is Muhammad. So in Islam, the cultural and economic and religious concerns were completely intermixed. Again, I'm repeating this point. Muhammad propagated his religion in the language of Arabs and suited their needs. Did not insist on conversions. Meccans were not forced to convert, though many did. So he took it easy. Muhammad was not aggressively propagating or wanting conversions. In fact, he never forced conversions. Whoever was converting to his Islam, his religious thought Islam, were doing it voluntarily. He did not insist on conversions. He talked about his religion in the language, in Arabic. And it also talked about, the religion talked about the needs of the people, the social problems that it addressed, the social problems that people were facing. So the religious revelations in Quran are the core of Islam. But message from 1622 CE was of an expanding aggressive political power, a new version of the old idea of group solidarity. So it constantly talked about expanding political power. Yes. So Islam as a religious thought, and Muhammad at its helm, constantly talked about aggressive political power, expanding politically, geographically. Muhammad convinced that his mission was to unite the Arabs in the worship of Allah. The nature and character of his authority grew and changed with time. So, of course, Muhammad, as a leader of Islam, was convinced that his main job or his main mission was to unite the Arab people in the Arabian Peninsula. because he knew that there were constant in fights and feuds and war battles happening within among the people, among different clans, he wanted to unite all of these people under the worship of Allah. Yeah. He established peace in Arabia. However, he realized that no effective political unification of Arabs was possible as they lived off each other. So an external target had to be found. And amongst his final acts, he attempted to secure the roads of Iraq and Syria. So because the nature of Arabia, historically, if you see, they were constantly, the regions were constantly fighting with each other. So Prophet's main mission was to unite Arabian. How would the people of Arabia be united? He thought that under the worship of Allah, yes, he would be able to unite the people of Arabia. But still he realized that people would not be united like that. Because they were constantly fighting and they would constantly fight with each other. They were always living off each other, you know, defeating each other and being victorious, defeating each other. So he thought of an external target had to be found. That means that expansion had to be done and regions of Iraq and Syria also had to be attempted to secure. Now, moving from the rise of Islam and all the discussion that we had around that, the second theme of this particular unit is the rule of the first four caliphs. Now, I'm not going to go into the details of every caliph, but generally keep three points in your mind. After the death of Muhammad, no one could succeed him as a prophet. He designated no political successor. But because it was for the ummah, the community, someone was needed to guide the temporal affairs of the community. Therefore, appointment of a successor who came to be called as caliph. So, there were appointment of a successor who was called as caliphs, who were to be called as caliphs. And this was purely because there was somebody who was needed to guide the temporal affairs. Now, the religious affairs or the religion was pretty clear. Because there were the Quran and Hadiths, the whatever Prophet had left his sayings, that was the basis of religion. But what about the affairs of the community, the Ummah? That had to be handled, and therefore the appointment of successor, who were known as caliphs, was done. Now caliphs had no authority in matters of religious doctrine, because it was always available, which was available to only Prophet. Prophet had. The Prophet Muhammad who had the rights over religion and the religious affairs and the religious principles. Caliphs did not have any authority on that matter. Decision was taken through a process of discussion and consent. The first four caliphs had all been closely associated with Muhammad and were rightly referred to as the rightly guided ones. Yes, so please look at the details of the caliphs Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, Caliph, and the fourth Caliph Ali. Please look at the details. I'm skipping this now. Quickly going to what was happening after the four caliphs. The Umayyads clan had taken over the caliphate. So I'm going to discuss the Umayyad caliphate now. Many historians see the establishment of Umayyad Caliphate as an abandoning of the original ideals of Islam as a theocratic community. Now, let's see that how historians are looking at Caliphate. Now, Caliphs who were seen as successors after Umayyad Caliphate took control, many historians saw them as abandoning of original ideals of Islam. And it was replacement by a secular kingship. Now, what is theocratic community? Theocratic is practicing one religion. Theocracy is one religion. This is Islam. So many historians saw that Umayyad Caliphate were abandoned this one religion policy, the theocracy community. And it was replaced by secular kingship. That means people of other religion were also started being entertained, or other religions and philosophy were also started to be integrated in the broad framework of the Islamic thought. Let's see how the political unity provided by them made it possible for Muslims to dwell on, elaborate upon the inner meanings of Quran, dissemination among Muslims over a span of several generations. So there is no doubt that Umayyad Caliphate had given some kind of a political unity And that made people settle at one place, think about what their religion is, what Quran is. And over a period of time, over a span of generations, there were dissemination of principles of Islam. Umayyads proclaimed Damascus, which is the capital of Syria. I've already located this initially on the map as the seat of the caliphate. They were now less dependent on the approval from the holy cities of Mecca and Medina. So from Mecca and Medina, now the capital of the caliphate, Umayyad caliphate, shifted to Syria, which is towards the northern Arabian Peninsula, Syria, Damascus. And they were less dependent on the holy city of Mecca and Medina. Some of the rulers, the caliphs of Umayyad caliphate were Muawiyah, Yazid, Manwan, Abd al-Malik and al-Walid. So please look at the details on about them from the resource. Now, with Umayyad Caliphate, there was also a gradual decline of the Umayyads, a succession, and this was because of the succession of weak and dissolute rulers, increase in number of conversions that had led to serious repercussions, failed attempts to take Constantinople. Now, Constantinople was a very, very critical region. Again, you can look at this on the map and you would exactly know why Constantinople was being desired by, you know, the Umayyad Caliphate is to take control of Constantinople, but they failed. Now, in this constant annexation and expansion, resources of the state command were depleted. There was loss of wealth and manpower, and caliphal prestige also suffered. So these are some of the reasons which led to decline of the Umayyads. And after the Umayyads caliphate, the Abbasid clan began were the head of the caliphate world. Now, the Abbasid caliphate came to power espousing many popular causes, particularly the claims of Shias. Now, when Abbasids came to head the caliphate, they were particularly sensitive to the claims of Shias. Now, please keep in your mind the difference between the Sunni and the Shia. They both are practicing Islam, but again, there is a huge difference in the way they practice and understand Islam and perspective towards Islam. Abbasid caliphate treat the caliphate as an absolute monarchy, based their power on military support of their Khurasani soldiers. Now, Khurasani, when I say Khurasani, is the Iran area, the Khurasan area. I'd also mentioned about the Sasanian Empire, the region of Iran, the Persian caliphate, Persia. So they had based their power on the military support of Khurasani soldiers. They built the city of Baghdad and made it their capital. So from Damascus, Syria, this capital of the caliphate shifted. The Abbasid caliphate now made Baghdad as the capital. There were no province barring perhaps Syria, which was discriminated against. Now, Syria was discriminated in the sense was seen as an enemy of the Abbasid caliphate. And naturally so, because of the differences that Umayyad and Abbasids have. They tried to remove differences between the Arabs and the new Muslims, widened the base of their power by introducing non-Arabs into the ruling elites, ulema to work towards evolving a comprehensive cultural traditions like law, which was called Sharia, jurisprudence, which is called fiqh, philosophy, falsafa, for the rest of the Muslims. So a lot is happening during the Abbasid Caliphate period. Now they're trying to widen their base, include a lot of non-Arabs. They're giving a lot of powers to ulema, who would now be important to evolve a comprehensive cultural tradition, a law which will eventually be known as Sharia, jurisprudence, the reasoning, the jurisprudence, fiqh becomes very important. We'll look at it a little later. So this started to be kind of formalized or institutionalized during the Abbasid Caliphate period. Abbasids had huge influence from the Sasanian Iranian predecessor. So I had shown you in the first few maps the Sasanian area, which is the Iranian area. So Iranian predecessors of the Sasanians have a huge influence on the Abbasid Caliphate. For example, the concept of aura of divine glory, the shadow of God on earth. Now, these were concepts that became very, very important and core to the Abbasid Caliphate. Caliphs became more and more unapproachable because they saw themselves as a shadow, divine shadow of God on earth, and all of that. The some of the rulers and caliphs of Abbasid Caliph were Al-Safa, Al-Mansur, Al-Mahdi, Harun Al-Rashid, Al-Amin, Al-Mamun, Al-Mamun, Al-Mutasmim, Al-Wasik, Mudawakkil, and Mutadid. So these were the Abbasid, the caliphs under the Abbasid. Now, under the Abbasids, also the new Ikta system gradually came, was an outcome of the two previous existing institutions, tax farm and the Amirate or provincial government. The military commanders were given Iklas or land grants within the provinces. Iklas became crucial institutions in the militarized state that later emerged from the wreckages of Abbasid Empire. So again, the second point is also about the Ikta. So because by the Abbasid Caliphate, geographically and politically, there was the caliphate had really expanded a lot. And how do you control the provinces? How does the caliphate control the provinces? And this was done through giving the Ikta or the Ikla lands, which I've already mentioned, the land grants that were given to military commanders, yes? And so by the end of their rule, Abbasid rule, Ikta was the only way to control the provinces. Decline of central authority, caliphs had great difficulty now to even quell a series of disturbances and rebellions. There were new movements against caliphs concentrated in territorial blocks. Population preferred an effective local ruler than to a distant and ineffective caliph. So you will see that how as the reach of Islam and the caliph had gone beyond the Arabian Peninsula, it was difficult to control the regions. And it was only through Ikta, giving away land grants to military commanders, they could really control and have some aspect of control on different regions. So the caliph himself became ineffective because he was away, he was distant. And the local governor, who was called the Iktidar, the holder of that province, became more important. He became the local governor and he became very, very strong and powerful. We also saw a series of rebellions and other groups that emerged with the weakening of the caliphate, the Abbasid caliphate. The Samanids came to control northeast Iran. The Buyids occupied Baghdad and finally controlled the caliphs in 949 CE. So caliphate or caliph per se still continued to exist, but his role was purely symbolic and religious. So really, you know, if you look at the way Islam had spread and the way a caliphate after the first four caliphs, the Umayyads and the Abbasids, the nature of the caliphate had dramatically changed over a period of time. And by the 10th century, it was a different scene altogether. And if you can relate a little bit of all of this to, the coming of the Delhi Sultans and all of that, you'll be able to completely see the continuity of how Islam and the traditions of the Sassanids, the Persian and, the Arabic and the Iranian, how they flowed in India through the Delhi Sultans and, then later through the Mughals. So anyway, that's not something that concerns us at present. We will quickly look at the second unit of this particular block after studying the rise of Islam and all the caliphate. What were these religious developments and the origins of Sharia? Now, particularly the Abbasid time, the Abbasid Caliphate, like if you look at the second point that I've discussed in this slide, the development of Sharia, fiqh, philosophy, all of this really developed at this point of time. So we'll look at more details on this particular thing. So the four broad themes in this particular unit is the historical origins of Sharia, the religious developments, the traditional jurisprudence, fiqh, and the branches and school of law. Very quickly, the historical origins, the word Sharia is used by Arabic-speaking people of the Middle East to designate a prophetic religion in its totality. Now, Sharia is something which is clearly taken from what Prophet is talking about. It is to the prophetic religion, that the prophetic religion of Islam that Prophet Muhammad had propagated to the people of Arabia, Arabic speaking people in the Middle East, the Arabian Peninsula that one is talking about. Within Islamic discourse, Sharia refers to religious regulations governing the lives of Muslims. So how a Muslim should live, what should be his religious mind, how should he regulate himself in his daily life, a Muslim, should be in context to Sharia. It should be in tandem with Sharia. For many, the word simply means justice, the word Sharia. And they will consider any law that promotes justice and social welfare to conform to Sharia. In Muslim literature, Sharia is designated as the law or message of a prophet or God. In contrast to fiqh, which refers to a scholar's interpretation thereof. Now, it's very, very important to understand this point here. Prophet is Prophet Muhammad and God is Allah. Now, whatever God or Allah and Prophet is saying is designated as Sharia. It comes under the law or message from these, or from the Prophet and God, which is designated as Sharia. In contrast to this, fiqh or jurisprudence, yes, is referred to the scholar's interpretation, the ulema's interpretation, or people's interpretation of Sharia, or of what the God is saying, or of what the Prophet is saying. The major precepts of Sharia were passed down directly from Islamic Prophet Muhammad. The emergence of fiqh also goes back to the lifetime of Muhammad. So during the lifetime of Muhammad itself, the idea of fiqh or scholar's interpretation had already begun. So it wasn't that after the death of Prophet Muhammad, fiqh really, or jurisprudence or interpretations started to take place. Yes. So the emergence of fiqh goes back to the lifetime of Muhammad. Most canonical hadiths are the sayings of, or what Prophet Muhammad on his daily basis in his mundane life used to say or reveal. It's called the hadith. So the most canonical hadiths did not originate with Muhammad, but were actually created at a later age. Right? Now, it remains a subject of scholarly controversy. Now, hadith is something that there is a major scholarly controversy that what are these hadiths, but generally hadiths were the sayings of Prophet Muhammad, and they are also a very important religious text for understanding Sharia, understanding Sharia, the most important canon. Generally accepted that fiqh developed out of a combination of administrative and popular practices shaped by religious and ethical precepts of Islam. So the traditional jurisprudence, the fiqh, which I've spoken about, the scholarly interpretations, fiqh was divided into two fields: usul of fiqh, the roots of fiqh, which studies the theoretical principles of jurisprudence, and furu of fiqh, the branches of fiqh, devoted to elaboration of the rulings on the basis of these principles. So these are two broad fields of fiqh. Now, human reason, human reasoning is a gift from God, which should be exercised to its full capacity. So what is the basis of fiqh? Fiqh means that scholars could interpret what Muhammad and God is saying. Yes, they have the right to interpret. Now, why do they have the right to interpret? Because generally accepted was that human reasoning or mind was a gift from God, and that should be exercised to its full capacity. So this was the rational argumentation of this human reason should draw its content from a body of transcendental knowledge revealed in Quran through the Sunnah of Muhammad. So human reason is important, but human reason should be based on, or should draw on, the knowledge of Quran and Sunnah of Muhammad. So your knowledge, your interpretation is important. Scholars' interpretation is important. Yes, ulema's interpretation is important. Fiqh is important, but it has to be in tandem with, in context with, in totality with what Quran reveals, what is revealed in Quran and through the Sunnah of Muhammad. The sources of Sharia are Sharia, the historical text of Islam, are Quran, which is the most sacred source of law, Hadith, which provides and details the practical and legal guidance, Qiyas, analogical reasoning, They are all used to derive a ruling for a situation not addressed in scriptures by analogy with scripturally a scripturally based rule. Now, the classic process of ijtihad, I think I'll skip this, the idea of mujtahid that became more popular, people who also thought of themselves as, again, messengers who claimed to have the mind to interpret and understand Quran and Sharia, and they would they also had their followers and all. So I'm not going to touch upon this. Maqasid, which is the aim or purpose of Sharia, and Masla, which is the welfare or public interest, are also two related classical doctrines. Now there's a lot of information on this. Please take a look at a resource. You'll have to read it again and again to make sense of it, because it's slightly difficult. My last slide is on the branches in school of law. Now, again, a technical term, furu al-fiqh, is traditionally divided into ibadat, the rituals or acts of worship, and muamalat, the social relations. Muamalat. I may be pronouncing many of this wrongly, because my understanding of Arabic is not that great, and I'm not very good at pronunciation of Arabic terms. Nevertheless, I'm sure that's the reason I've also written the English meaning of it in the brackets. Several crimes with scripturally prescribed punishments are known as hudud. Now, classical jurisprudence is described as one of the major intellectual achievements of Islam. It was later elaborated by private religious scholars who issued fatwas, and they were issued by qualified jurists. Now, there were many branches in school of laws who claimed that they could interpret and Quran and make that more accessible to people. And through they were largely also issuing legal opinions in form of fatwa. And they were issued by qualified jurists. It's still done. Different school of thoughts still in contemporary world issue fatwas, and jurists who are called muftis. The main Sunni school of law madhabs are Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi, the Hanbali madhab. Now these were important, very very popular madhabs or school of law that emerged in the 9th and 10th century. Now, they recognized each other's validity and have interactions in legal debates over centuries. The development of Shia legal schools also occurred along the lines of theological differences, and that resulted in formation of 12 Zaydi and Ismaili madhabs. So, parallelly to Sunni, even the Shia legal schools had also emerged on, and all of these legal schools draw themselves on, from Sharia. They drew their main precepts and from Sharia. But again, the difference was in the scholarly interpretations that they had. And this led to different schools of law and branches within the broad framework of Islam. So let me just take you through this, since I have the map in front of me. So I was talking about the Persian Sassanid Empire, from which became the seat of the Caliphate under the Abbasid Caliphate, and Syria, if you look at Damascus, this was Umayyads. So this is what I would like to explain. It's a very very complicated and also a very difficult block, I would say that, and I would encourage students to study this at least 3 to 4 times, and then only they'll be able to relate to concepts related to this block. And my lecture may be a little difficult this time, and that's because the region, the terminology, the language that one is discussing, the religion that one is talking about, it needs to be understood more deeply and through historical processes and continuity. And I would only want to say that please read the resource. It's given in great detail, and then try and look at my lecture and listen to my lecture. So if there's any question, again, you can ask as of now, or also write me an email. I would like to go and This is it from my presentation side. I hand it over to Professor Mishra now. Thank you. Nishant, I would like Professor Mishra to respond in case he's around, or anybody else who's moderating this session. Yes.
I think so.
So, Nishant, Professor Mishra seems to have is not present in our discussion right now. If there's any question, maybe you can see if there's any question coming in, then I can take up. Or
no, ma'am, no question.
Sorry.
No question.
No question as of now. Okay, your voice is not quite audible, Nishant.
Hello. I'm
So should we close for the day today, in the sense, close our lecture for the day?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you so much, everyone. And please write me a mail in case there's any question or discussion that needs to be further done. Thank you so much. Namaskar. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Nishant, should we close?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.